Hello, Flosstube. I'm back. These things aren't getting any easier to make. I've already started this about 10 times today. I'm hoping this one's going to stick because otherwise I'm going to be here till midnight, having done umpteen versions of the first 10 seconds of the video. I spent a couple of months since I made a video. I hope everybody's okay and enjoying stitching and life in general. It's been quite a busy couple of months for me. I made my last video at the end of Christmas, I think. And I go straight into my busy period at work straight after that. If anybody does accountancy, they'll know exactly what I mean, particularly in this country when I say that January is a fairly hectic month for accountants. It wasn't any easier this year than it ever is, but we got through it. And then I was straight into things with my choir that I sing with, and I'm also getting quite busy with the play that I've mentioned before now. I've had my audition evenings for As You Like It and fully cast that, so that's all going to be kicking off at the beginning of next month, but hopefully there should always be time for stitching. And I've got a few things sorted and done, so I thought it might be an idea to show you progress to date and what I'm working on going forward. I think the last time I saw you, I was still kind of hoping that I was going to get through a couple of projects that I didn't get through in time to have them ready for Christmas. You may have noticed, by the way, I'm clearly in a different setting. I've bought an iPad since I made my last video, and I was very conscious that the quality of the last video was really quite poor. It was very juddery, stop-starty, grainy, so apologies for not having got that sorted out. But again, I'd spent so long making the video that in the end I thought I can't face doing it all again. I'll send out what I've recorded, and it wasn't the best quality, but I hope it was watchable, my little trip down memory lane with the things that I've done so far to date. So as I left it in December, I hadn't quite finished my Christmas stocking. I might as well start showing you things that I've been working on. I thought I was organised and had everything ready, and clearly I haven't, because I can't put my hand on anything now. There we go, I've got it. So, you will recall, I was working on this Santa's flight stocking in the hopes that it was going to be done by Christmas and hanging on the fireplace, which it wasn't. It took me virtually to the end of January to get this finished. There was an awful lot more work in it than I thought there was. Before I show it, some of you may have seen it because I put it up on Stitchmania and Instagram anyway, so it may not be a surprise to you to see this. I can only lay claim to the cross stitch. I can't lay claim to anything else that's done on this. This is Santa's flight stocking completed. Ta-da! Here it is. Very proud of this one. It looks absolutely wonderful, and that's all down to the pattern, not to me. I hasten to add, I just followed a pattern. And my other half, Nigel, who I've mentioned before, finished this off for me and turned it from a piece of cloth into a stocking. So I'll do a bit of close-up on it, because with this iPad, the quality is great compared to what I've been used to, so I'm hoping. And I hope people notice as well. Did you see what I did there? Look at that. Centered first time. That's the advantage of not working back to front. Although everything's looking back to front on the screen, that's the disadvantage. Anyway, if I come in close, you can see here a little bit of gold braiding. I didn't mention when I was making the kit that I had all manner of problem with the metallic threads that the dimensions kit had included. It was horrible stuff to work with. It just tangled and knotted and frayed, and it was always wanted. The pattern was always asking that it be used with something else, so it was tweeded, and it was just awful to work with. So I had some petite treasure braid gold left over from when I'd finished Michael, the angel who I showed in the last video. So I thought, well, I'll try this and see if it's any better, and it was as different again. It was great to work with. So you can see that there is some tweeded gold metallic thread in Nigel's name there. Then this is pure petite treasure braid, and then the carriage is absolutely laced with metallic thread. I think this is okay. It was a late one Sunday night. I was desperate to finish this. I just wanted it out and done. I was supposed to couch some of the gold work on here, and I looked at it and thought, you know, I really hate couching at the best of times. and I can't face coming back to this another day, so I'll just see what it looks like if I just stitch it. And I don't think you can tell particularly. There's a bit of glare on this, actually. Sorry, I don't know. I wonder about that glare. I don't think you can tell particularly. It's just sort of a mess of filigree gold work, really. So I'm pretty happy with that. So coming in a bit close again, as the first bunch of ready. I just love this pattern. I think it's a really nice design. I haven't worked out why Santa's wearing green gloves. I don't get that, but anyway, I'm not one to deviate from a pattern. The little bag of balls, that finished off quite nicely when it was stitched up with its string netting around it. And finally, my ship, which just looked like a blobby mess for so long, looks like a ship now. There is a fiendish amount of backstitching in this, and I've said before, I'll say it now that I didn't enjoy the backstitch on this, but on the one of the other patterns I'm going to show you, I did enjoy it more. I think it just depends on the circumstances, and with a lot of this, where you're just outlining things that are very heavily stitched anyway, I just didn't enjoy it, really. And again, I cheated a little bit. There were supposed to be a lot of branches and tree work in here that I thought, I don't need that, I'm not going to do it, so I didn't do it. But pretty pleased on the whole. Look at this, I can even turn it sideways with no messing. I've got to turn it sideways because I have stitched this with no clue as to what it was, because I was stitching it this way and thought, well, it's something, I can't see it. And it was only when it was being put together as a stocking that I noticed it's a fire engine with a tiny little ladder across the top. So there you go. You discover new things all the time. So, Nigel made this up into a stocking for me. He's a real whiz with a sewing machine. It is backed with velvet. We only ever wanted to go with something plain on the back, not a patterned fabric or anything quilted. So it's some velvet, midnight blue velvet that we found on eBay. The kits themselves come with felt backing, and it's quite insubstantial, and you know, it's not for dimensions to be giving us lavish materials to finish off. You know, the kits cost enough for them to manufacture anyway, I would think. But it just felt very insubstantial for something that had so much work divested in it, so we went for velvet instead. And then Nigel quite liked the idea of continuing the red border at the top here into the back. So we found this sparkly stuff, which is rather nice. Corded it so that it hangs nicely at the right angle, and then found this rather lush cording, gold cording, to go around the top, and finished it off with this little band on the edge. It's fully lined right the way down there. These are some old napkins that we had that we weren't using that were the right colour, so the napkins have been sacrificed, so we'll have to eat like pigs now. And there it is. Santa's Flight Stocking from Dimensions kit. It took about 3.5 months to complete this, and it's a great stitch. I've always been quite biased. The Dimensions kits that I've done in the past, I've always hated this idea of them using 4 strands and 5 strands and 3 strands and having to pull thread through the fabric and it being, you know, really quite an arduous task. For some reason that didn't seem to bother me at all. With this kit, there's a lot of half stitching that's done with I think it's a maximum of 4 threads, in fairness, that you were pulling through here to create this sort of texture. But the needle that they provided or something was different when I did it this time, and it really wasn't a problem to me at all. So hopefully next Christmas, it will be hanging on the fireplace. The hopefully bit is that I've now got to do another one with my name on it. The one that I picked to do, which I shall be doing probably over the summer, is called Welcome Santa Stocking. There we go. Which seemed like a nice sort of companion piece in red. So we already have some backing fabric in red for this one. And I think that'll be rather nice. I suspect this one will not be as long to stitch up. It's not quite as complicated in its pattern. And because a lot of it's white and it's on white cloth, the pattern cheats a little bit and doesn't, you know, leave some of the cloth exposed. So I have to bring that into plan as to when I'm going to do this to get it ready for Christmas, so that I don't have that panic again that I had this year to try and get Santa's flight finished and didn't, which was slightly disappointing. But then it'll be nice to have them both hanging up at the same time. So that's coming into the mix at some point this year. After I'd finished the Santa's flight stocking, I went straight back into the Country Mouse and the City Mouse, because if you recall from whichever video I showed it on, I was one page off finishing the second row. And I at least wanted to get that done. So, here's a reminder again of what I'm stitching here. The Country Mouse and the City Mouse, designed by Scott Gustafson from Heaven and Earth Designs. I am stitching it on 25 count Belfast linen, 2/1, not tent, just little half stitches. I've explained before how I've now had a wonderful tutorial provided by, you see, I should have done my homework. You know who you are, a wonderful lady. Oh, I'm so sorry. How can I have forgotten your name? And I got the pronunciation right last time. It's Saturday afternoon and I'm not thinking well. Anyway, I've seen a tutorial that showed the difference between continental stitch and, or tent stitch, and just half stitches, but made the executive decision that I wasn't going to change halfway through, because it changed the appearance on the front. It made the stitching a little bit thicker on the front. So I'm sticking with what I've already achieved on this and going ahead. So here we go. Again, I've already sort of shown this. Now, does it make a difference if I put it? Makes no difference at all, does it? You see, that absolutely makes no difference putting that on the back. So it's fine. Okay. So here we are with the Country Mouse and the City Mouse, with, ta-da, end finished. This, it felt like it took forever. I don't know why it took so long. It's no more complicated than any of the rest of it, but it did feel like it was taking a ridiculous amount of time to finish that one little page. So we'll come in a bit closer. You can see that the coverage isn't 100%, but I quite like that. It gives it kind of a nice textured feel. And what I don't want is a piece that looks as if it's not a cross stitch anymore. I want it to have a texture of a fabric. So you can see little bits here and there where the coverage hasn't been ideal. But like I say, I quite like that. So I did start the next page down here, just a little bit on Monday night, last Monday evening. And I was straight into, well, I think it's sweet corn, or corn on the cob. I think that's what it is. You may tell me differently, but I was straight into that. I didn't realise, I thought I'd got a lot more pot to do, but I had no pot. I went straight into corn on the cob. So there we go. We've already sort of talked about how wonderful the teapot looks on this design. And again, that's all down to the charting of Heaven and Earth Designs and the original, I feel like Chad. Now I've thrown myself. The charting on the original Heaven and Earth Designs pattern. But I think it's sort of worth pointing out as well that it's not just the sort of the marvel of this shine, but it's the fact that all these other things in the picture look like what they're supposed to look like. So this is very much an earthenware pot, and this is a very crumbly cake, and this is very kind of, you know, smooth icing. So it's a great thing. I now have one more full row and a bit of a row to do. So I don't know how long it's going to take. But there we go. Progress has been made and a row has been finished, and that's an achievement to me. Oh, I was going to also show off my extensive needleminder collection in this video, so there it is. There's my needleminder. I have the one, and even he's upside down. There he is, little dragon. I may buy more. I did buy another one, and the top fell off it, so it kind of put me off buying needleminders, really. So I just keep shifting that from whatever I'm using to whatever I'm using at the moment. Country Mouse and the City Mouse. I have worked on another something as well. I suddenly the Janlin Spring sampler was calling, so I thought I'd give that some attention and love as well. I should also show this off. this bag, again, this is Nigel's handiwork. He's great with the sewing machine. And I quite like the idea of having some specially made bags to put the frames in. There is one on the way for the Country Mouse and the City Mouse frame. This is my Millennium frame. And so Nigel made me a zipped bag with fully lined. And it gives me enough space in here to keep the frame and the pattern and everything. So the kit's sort of self-contained in the bag, which is quite nice. Keeps everything neat and tidy together. There isn't a lot of progress on this because I've only just been tickling it this week. But you will recall that I've got the 4 Janlin season samplers. And I've been working on spring. So here's the spring sampler. Incredibly detailed and incredibly fiddly. But what I like about these patterns, and I've said it before, is that you can do a bit and it feels like a finish in and of itself. Every element of it feels like its own finish. Just so you can see down the side here, I may show them at some other time as well, but again, I think most people are familiar with the others in the series. But there's, oh, that's spring anyway. And there's summer, autumn, and winter, which Brian's working on over at Blitz Stitch and doing a remarkable job with it. I think the autumn one was the earliest because to me it seems the most, primitive in style. They seem to get more sophisticated as they go along. And spring is certainly a lot of work. I'd, again, forgotten just how long these things take. You put them away and you think, oh, just knock a bit more out on that, and then of course you sit down to do it, and by the end of the evening you don't know what you've done because it's so insignificant. But what I've done differently to this, if you will recall where I already was with it, all this sort of top banding was already done, so all I've done is this seed packet here, which, to put that back again so that you can see what it's going to be, little seed packet there of hollyhocks. And the hollyhocks themselves in that pattern, they're going to take forever. A lot of confetti, but that's fine. When I talked about not enjoying backstitch, the exception to the rule is this pattern, because for some reason, I don't know why it should be, but I really enjoy the backstitching on this pattern. Now, I don't know whether it's because you're not backstitching over heavily stitched areas already, like I was with my Santa stocking, I don't know, and that you're just outlining things more. I don't know why this should be different to any other backstitching that I do, but I do really enjoy the backstitching on this, and I had a blast putting hollyhock in the other night. So last night I just took that seed packet further down, and I'll probably work on this again today later on and see how much further I can get. I think I've sort of told you before that, that was a first for this video. What sort of threw me on this was how long all this sort of flower work was taking around here. Again, very confetti heavy, a lot of half stitches, which I don't mind, but they're time consuming. So we kind of lost a bit of impetus with that. But it's coming on, and it's such a colourful thing, this. It's just full of colour and vibrancy and joy and exactly what you want from a pattern that's depicting spring. There's my other needle minder, sans top, so I'm just using the magnet at the moment, but that's fine, it works. I may buy some more needle minders at some point, but I don't know, we'll see. So that's spring sampler. There it is one last time. Hurrah, rush out and buy it. It's a really nice pattern and a lot of fun to work with. I think I hadn't appreciated, because I bought the kits for all of these, didn't spend a lot of them. I always sort of waited until I found them a little bit cheaper. But Brian indicated that there's a website, I think, that you can buy these patterns from and kit them up yourself. And I think they use DMC threads anyway, so the kitting up of them isn't difficult because you can just go straight into DMC threads. So if you don't want a kit, you could look at the pattern. There we go. Oh, there was one other thing that I found, I remembered that I'd done when I was doing my retrospective in the last video. And I was over at my mum's a few weeks ago, and I'd forgotten that I'd sent her this little birthday card one year. She's a big fan of orangutans. And I found a tiny little kit in Hobbycraft, It's only a couple of pounds. I can't show you the original because it's at my mum's house, but this, now you see I've got a glare problem again. Oh, look at that, I've got a double shadowing effect. Let me bring him in and see if that disappears. Anyway, he was just a little orangutan. He only took an evening to do. What I then did was spend a ridiculous amount of money on stamping ink and stamps and cards to finish the thing off. So the kit cost £2 and the rest of it probably cost another tenner. These blobby bits on the green, they're supposed to be animal print. It's an animal print stamp, but clearly you can see that I have nil skill when it comes to anything like card making. But he's cute. I thought he was cute. His mouth took a while to get right because his grin was quite lopsided when I first put it in. That's everything I've been working on. I thought I might show you just a couple of things that I've got in stash that I may be working on in the nearish future. Haven't we all got one of these? This one's Garrett's fault, Coffee Stitcher, who pointed it out to me after I'd finished or was working on Michael. In one of Coffee Stitcher's videos, he talked about Mirabilia's Archangel, and I thought, oh, that's another male angel. How many of those are there going to be to get? So I'll have to have him. Now, there is talk of Ed, Tattooed Stitcher, and Garrett, Coffee Stitcher, and myself possibly having some kind of stitch along on this. I don't know if it's going to happen or not. It's a nice thought. But if you don't know it, this is called Archangel by Mirabilia. For a Mirabilia, it's not that complex in terms of the materials, or there's no 1:1 in it, which I was slightly disappointed in when I looked at the chart. I was hoping that I'd get the opportunity for 1:1 again, but it wasn't meant to be. The reason this is potentially coming up my pile of to-dos, I'm getting so much glare. The reason this is possibly coming up on my list of things to do is because Nigel and I finally tied the knot last month. We've been together for 25 years, and with the changes in laws and so forth, we can now get married. So that's what we did. We had a very modest ceremony last month, well, a month ago today, actually, by coincidence. And yes, tied the knot with just some immediate family with us on the day. And the reason that I think this might be a nice thing to do is because you'll see that little manuscript is blank. So I thought I could stitch the date of our wedding onto it. And it would be a keepsake from this year. Hence, it might be coming up the pile of things to do, because it would be a nice thing to do this year. So that was one of the things that I bought relatively recently. Something else, I haven't bought a lot. I have bought a Teresa Wensler pattern off eBay in the last few days. Prior to that, the last thing I bought, literally the last thing I bought, was the Peacock Tapestry kit, which I showed in video 2. I've been really good. I've not bought anything. But I did find this kit that someone's clearly just nabbled out of a kit. What am I talking about? It's a chart. But clearly somebody's nabbled out of a magazine. I don't know what the magazine is, because it doesn't seem to be very clear. Oh, it's cross-stitch gold. There it is. It's very clear. It says right on the bottom, it's cross-stitch gold. And I was drawn to this because you keep hearing me whittling on. I'm directing a production of As You Like It this year. And this is our Shakespearean sampler. Now, I bet this'll not work if I don't put something behind it. So let's do that. So, here we go. I rather like this. It's nice. I'm not huge on sort of primitive samplers normally, but you know, it's got the theatrical connection, it's got the little Shakespearean people there, it's got little nods and references throughout to Shakespeare. Is that a mule, I think? So there we go, Midsummer Night's Dream. And you'd expect a skull somewhere, wouldn't you, really? But there isn't a skull. But it's rather a nice pattern. It's designed by Yvonne Horn. I've not heard of Yvonne Horn before, but she does nice samplers. So it's just a monochrome pattern. I'm thinking of doing it on a burgundy fabric, maybe using an ecru thread, but I don't know. That's the thought at the moment. That seems like quite a nice sort of Shakespearean colour scheme. If anybody has any strong opinions either way on that, please feel free. So, in theory, that's on the list of things to do. And again, it will be quite a nice one to do this year with being so involved with As You Like It. But because I'm so involved with As You Like It, I don't have the world's greatest amount of time this year. By the way, later. So, we'll see. I'll just whip through a few of these other things that are in this folder now I've got it out. This is something that somebody showed on a Flosstube video. Sorry, that's my memory again. Someone pointed this magazine out. Cross Stitch and Needlework from September 2010. And what I liked in this and what they showed was this Late Summer Village pattern. There's an artist who Dimensions have used a lot called, is it Charles Wyckoffsky? Charles Wyckoffsky? He does the cats. So the Frederick the Literate Cat and Maggie the Messmaker. And is it Max in the Adirondacks? And he also does very nice landscapes. And this immediately put me in mind. There's also that quilting design that a lot of people are doing. I really quite like this sort of quite whimsical style of design. So I picked this out, or rather saw it on Flosstube, thought, how am I going to get hold of that? Did a search on eBay, and believe it or not, this came from North Korea. It cost buttons, and it arrived. I ordered it and thought, that's not going to happen, is it? I'm not going to get it from North Korea. But it did, it arrived, it's here. It's a really nice magazine, actually. I don't know, maybe somebody could tell me if this is even still in publication. I don't know, I'd not heard of it before. But there's some really, really nice designs in it. There's some good stuff. It's because it's September 2010, it's very geared towards Halloween designs. There's a nice sampler there in pumpkins. I'm not big on Halloween. I'm one of those really miserable people who hide on Halloween because I don't believe in it. I think it's a very cynical festival. So that'll probably get me some dislikes. In here as well, let's have a little look-see. I've got this sweet little thing that was in a sale at so-and-so. So I picked it up for a couple of quid. Again, it's a primitive style of pattern. It's from Little House Needleworks, and it's called Mississippi Riverboat. Whoops! Mississippi Riverboat. Mississippi Riverboat. So there it is. I like the reference to Sawyer and Finn. It's just a lovely traditional American design. It only calls for, what's that, about a dozen colours? It's a tiny little pattern. I think it's not going to take long to do. It was a couple of quid. Caught my eye, and I was making the most of the fact that I'd ordered something to justify the postage, which actually at so-and-so, I don't know if it's still the case, but it was only a pound. I've not ordered anything from them recently to know if that's changed at all. Then I've got some Prairie Schoolers. So I've got the Prairie Schooler Farmer's Alphabet, which is rather lovely. I did start it. I completely miscounted. I completely loused up. It was never going to fit on the fabric. I threw my toys out. So I did get end on. I think I got maybe M and O as well. I got about three letters done on it. And you know how it is when something goes wrong, and you think, I could start this again. And you don't, because you're fed up with even looking at it. I think the last thing to show in here. Oh, well, I would have shown it. That's because it's in a different folder. But I've got this because I've got this doubled up. I need to do something with this copy. I was really, really lucky. I came to the Prairie Schooler party late, just about the time they folded. Said they weren't manufacturing or printing anything anymore. And my brain is addled today. Thread Garden has done the most fantastic Prairie Schooler alphabet sampler, all on one piece. It's absolutely magnificent. It's a beautiful thing. And of course, everybody, well, I thought, oh, I've got to do that. That's a beautiful thing. So I rushed out and bought ABC. Aren't they gorgeous? And I don't think they can possibly take that long to do. So I got ABC and thought, I'll get the rest. It'd be great, I'll do the whole alphabet. And I dithered and dathered and I missed the boat. And of course, so-and-so started to knock the particular charts off, and I thought, I can't do it. I'm never gonna have the full alphabet. So I thought, well, I'll just do ABC. And then magically the whole alphabet was up for sale on eBay. I didn't spend a stupid amount of money on it. Actually, it was about £50 to get the lot, which is a lot of money for some charts. But if I bought them from so-and-so as a full set, I don't think I would have been far off that anyway. So I don't think it was extortionate. In my head, I kept pushing my bid up and thinking, well, it's still only about the same price as it would have been on so-and-so. And I think I went slightly over what it had been on so-and-so, but I don't regret that decision. I'm happy with that. So there we go. If that was of interest, then I'm happy to show other things that I have. I've said before, I don't particularly collect fabrics and threads, but I do have quite a lot of kits. I've got a chatelaine that I bought. I've got a lot of Teresa Wensler kits and some other things as well. If I see them and they're cheap on eBay, I pick them up. Plus, a couple of years ago, Hobbycraft had a huge clearing out sale, and everything that they had got, virtually everything, was half price. And it was just too good a deal to miss out on. So whereas I'd always been very, very modest in my purchases, I suddenly found that I'd got more kits than I'm ever going to be able to stitch in a lifetime. But I don't think I'm unique in that respect. So there we go. A huge thank you again to how kind people have been to comment and like and subscribe. It's overwhelming, really, the generosity of spirit that people demonstrate. It may not mean a lot when you're just typing up a quick message to somebody, but it really does. And again, I've tried to respond to every message, and if I haven't, it's not because I didn't like your message or I've just been rude. I just, you know, that it takes a while to respond to the messages, but I'm, you know, will always try and do that. So huge thanks again to everybody. I'm still really enjoying watching everybody's Flosstube videos. I think it helps to keep the old stitchy bug going. You know, we all sort of complain about being enabled to buy more things, and I think, though, when you see everybody else's work, it does help you to keep your own moving along. So there we go. I'll wrap it up there. I'm at 33 minutes. That was longer than I expected it to be, because I really don't have a great deal to show. So I hope again that I've not outstayed my welcome, and I hope that the quality of this video is superior to the one that went before it. So I hope to see you again soon. Everybody have a good stitching weekend, and bye for now.